Joining us now is going to be Melody Baetens. She's the restaurant critic for the Detroit News. Great to have you with us here on the MegaCast.
Thanks, Ronnie. Good to be here.
Are these restaurants going to survive?
Many of them. I hope they all do. Yes. But like you said, there's, you know, another 2 weeks or more of no indoor dining, which means, you know, for many small bars, nothing. And for restaurants, it's either outdoor dining or carry out or a mix of both. You know, I'm seeing meal packages, family packs, cook at home, kind of groceries to go. They're getting really creative. They pivot every time this happens. What's good about February 1st is if they can open, then they'll get those Valentine's Day reservations, which is kind of the big hit and first hit of the year for restaurants. Also the Super Bowl for bars is going to be big, you know, to watch in sports bars and things like that. So hopefully the numbers will go down and the state will think it's safe enough. And February 1st is the date. And by then, I think we're looking at about 160 days of indoor dining ban throughout the last 12 months.
That really is astounding. And, you know, until you mentioned those two big days for the restaurant industry, I hadn't thought of those, which makes me think she may even delay it until after the 14th, because that's one of the things, you know, it was those holiday parties and those holiday gatherings that they were trying to avoid during this first ban. I will say one of the things, I do like the igloos, especially if you're lucky enough to get a reservation on a day that it's snowing. I feel like I'm in a snow globe when I get to go to them. But on the other side of that, I don't get this. What is the science behind this? Because I feel like all you're doing on so many of these venues is you're taking outdoors, you're indoor putting it outdoors, but it's indoors, but you're outdoors, so it's okay.
Right. And I think, and Whitmer's touched on this in her speech this week, what they want to avoid is people from different households gathering inside and taking their masks off. And in a dining room, though they're spread apart, you still have that. Whereas in one of the domes or the chalets or the greenhouses, all the different things that are coming out now, you've got one household, assumedly. I mean, you can meet up with friends, but you're separated from all the other diners, and the server comes in. When they come in, they have a mask on. You put your mask up, they leave the food, and then they leave. So, and then with disinfecting in between uses, that's, you know, supposed to be safer than indoor dining altogether, or one of those big tents where all the sides are closed. They really need to keep those sides open so there's airflow through if there's more than one table inside the tent.
Yeah, I've seen pictures of some of my friends at some of these bigger tents, and I'm like, the sides don't look open there. And I think a lot of times too, it has to do with the city that you're in and how strict the ordinance is or the enforcement is as well. I will say the greenhouse we live here in Keiko Harbor, B1, Bachelor One, they are actually starting to build some of those greenhouses now as well and kind of developing a beer garden outside to, you know, entice people to come to the restaurant. I think some of those things may stick around because they are cute. From a chick standpoint, I like them. I like the atmosphere, but it also goes to the relying on people to say that you're coming from the same household. We know that's not happening.
Right. And we're not supposed to gather in households. So I think a lot of people are saying, well, meet me for coffee, meet me for drinks and dinner. And, you know, because they're allowed to. I mean, we're not supposed to, but it is allowed. The restaurants are not supposed to say, oh, you guys don't live together, we can't see you together. That's not on them. So it's up to everyone, you know, individually to make those decisions. But you're right, they're cute, they're fun, they're definitely around to stay because I know restaurants have been putting a lot of money into these. And even if when indoor dining is allowed, when it warms up, when the numbers go down and everyone gets vaccinated, there's still going to be people that are concerned, and it's increasing their footprint. If they're allowed to do it, they're going to keep the outdoor spaces for sure.
But that is one of the things too, is we have to remember every time they make these additions, it's costing them money at a time when they're not bringing in money. So it can be very challenging for some of these restaurants to be able to do it. And others simply aren't able to, either, you know, due to their location or some other stumbling blocks that are in the way.
Right. And they, you know, they're trying to convey to the public that what you just said, that this is expensive. A lot of places are saying, you know, it's cost $50 to make the reservation, and then that comes off your bill, but you have to expend that just so it's worth it for them, because they may only have one or two domes or one or two shanties. And on a weekend, people want to get in. It's a very popular activity now because there's not much else to do. And people have to realize that, yeah, it's going to cost a monetary commitment up front so that they know they're getting, the restaurant is getting, you know, enough to cover being open.
Yeah, I was surprised when I made reservations that you had to give your card, and it was a $50 fee to reserve the spot. And it was in case you didn't show up as well.
Right. And $50, I think, is on the low end. I've seen upwards of $300 for bigger, bigger structures. Yeah, for sure.
What?
Yeah, I've seen it. But it comes off the bill. And these, you know, it's, if you have a 6-person table, you figure every person with dinner and drinks, $50 a person, you know, that's the commitment that they need a table to make if they want it, and they get booked.
And so the governor did recently, yesterday, she announced some of the funding to try to help some of these businesses as well as some of the employees, the $45 million program. $45 million is not going to go very far, up to $20,000 per restaurant or entity that does apply, $1,650 per individual, up to, we should say. And the one thing I find interesting about this as well, it's a 10-day window that you can apply, and it's not going to be on first come, first served basis. So was there any discussion about how they're going to try to allocate this money?
I haven't heard anything specifically about how they'll allocate it. I'm sure it's based on need and you know, numbers of employees, which has been a factor in the past, but I've heard a lot from restaurant owners that this is not enough. It's not coming soon enough. It's not coming often enough. Employees as well, especially for places, like I said, that don't have a carryout business, that it's just not that type of restaurant, or they don't have a kitchen. They just serve drinks, and that's how they've, you know, existed for decades. You know, thinking of old neighborhood bars and longstanding neighborhood watering holes that just don't do, you know, they're not going to do a carryout 6-pack of Budweiser if that's what they sell normally, because you can get that at the party store, the liquor store. So I think that, you know, it's good that there's money coming, but I feel like from what I'm hearing from business owners, it's just not enough, not yet.
I'll be honest. I think a lot of times when they hold this press conference and they make that amount of money accessible, it's nothing more than for a political headline, because we all know anyone that can read between the lines, it's really not doing, even putting a dent in trying to help some of these individuals and these businesses stay afloat. Because $20,000, if you've been closed since the middle of November, that's not even keeping you know, the lights on. You're not paying anyone out of that money either.
Right. And you got to figure rent and the costs of you know, the state has done some things. They expanded the deadline to renew liquor licenses, and I think there's been some sales tax deadlines that they've expanded and been lenient on. But yeah, if you've got lights on, you got to keep them on. You've got to pay insurance. There's a lot of costs that people don't think about. Even if you aren't open, there are still bills to pay.
I wonder how this is going to reshape the city of Detroit and its restaurant scene long-term, because they were on such an upswing, but there was some argument that it was becoming pretty saturated as well for that downtown area. Are some of them going to close and remain closed? And is it going to have a long-term impact on that restaurant scene in Detroit?
Absolutely. I mean, before the pandemic, people were saying it's saturated. We saw a handful of high-profile restaurants close in January, Gold Cash Gold in Corktown. The kind of new Fort Street Galley, which was kind of a incubator, you know, food hall style restaurant, they closed after about only 2 years. Bistro 82 in Royal Oak, Green Space in Ferndale, Craftwork in West Village. We saw a lot of places that were kind of part of the fabric of the restaurant scene closed. And that was before the pandemic. So it was cutthroat. There was a lot of competition, not just for diners, but for good employees. Restaurant owners have told me before this, and especially during this, that finding people to stay on, especially, you know, front of house, back of house managers, it's been a struggle. And that was before this, because there's just a lot of places opening and there's not a lot of people that work in the industry. The balance isn't there yet.
Well, I think too, what you're seeing going forward, there's been so much uncertainty in the restaurant industry. Some people are going to be leaving it altogether.
Absolutely. And we've seen that. I know I've seen some people, you know, that I've known as a bartender or a server, and they like pop up as a real estate agent this year. I've seen a lot of people leave the industry for more stable, you know, go back to school, get into different industries, because it was a hard industry. It's hard work. It's on your feet. There's the different wage things with the tipping wage, which can be a struggle to have a consistent wage. You know, a server might make twice as much in December that they will in January. So it's hard to, you know, financially stable yourself in the industry. So there's a lot of struggles. And now they're also, you know, they're on the front lines because they're serving people, but they're not really in that conversation. It's like people in the hospitals and grocery stores are.
We had the owner of the grill on a couple of weeks ago, and you could feel the frustration and the anger as well from some of these business owners. Long-term, just like employees are getting out of the business, do you think you're also going to see some of the owners say enough? Because even if we reopen with the vaccine, we're still looking at 6-8 months, if not longer, before we reach some type of herd immunity and we get back to normal again.
I think we'll see, it'll run the gamut. We'll have the diehard restaurant owner, bar owner that are going to stay and stick with it. We'll have people that can afford to just, you know, waltz into another industry. And we'll have people that'll pivot. I think we'll see a lot more restaurants use part of their space as a market. I think we'll see a lot more online sales, a lot more shipping. Even Buddy's joined Bold Belly. Which is a national kind of, they ship food, regional food from all over the country. I think we'll see them pivot into different styles more than the traditional restaurant where you make a reservation, you come in and you sit down. I think we'll see a lot of changes within the industry to accommodate less indoor dining and more safety and something to operate with less employees too.
I will say, I think one of the good things to come out of Starbucks is DoorDash now, because I remember there'd be Saturday mornings. I'm like, oh, I just wish Starbucks would deliver. Well, it kind of does in a way now.
Yeah. I mean, I never did DoorDash or Uber Eats. I always thought, you know, the car's there, just go get it. And now it's a whole different ballgame. I feel like people have, once you've done it once or twice, maybe you buy the fast pass or whatever it is, you're committed to ordering more. And in a note about that, it's always good if you do order delivery, check with the restaurant directly, because those fees can really get them with the third party apps. They're very convenient and it's good for getting the restaurant's name out there. But a lot of them are doing in-house delivery to avoid those fees. So if you have a favorite, I say check with them before, because they might deliver right to your house.
Yeah, it because we do forget about the fees and how much they're actually getting out of that. I know some of the bigger restaurants here in the Keiko Harbor, Sylvan Lake area, they're struggling right now. But we also have a new business that has been building their facility. I think it's called Sylvan Table.
Yeah.
And I wonder, what's it going to be like for some of these businesses that have been building to open, but we're in the middle of a pandemic? It's exactly. Got to be concerning.
Absolutely. And from what I've heard from, you know, there was supposed to be, you know, a set number of restaurants that I was expecting to open in 2020 that I was excited to see. Now it's going to be 2021. But like you said, like Sylvan Table, there's a lot of places downtown. I'm seeing there's, you know, delays with city governments because people are working from home. So it's hard to get those permits, hard to get people out there. There's delays with construction. There's delays in the supply chain. But we are still seeing new places open. In today's news, I have a story on Supino Pizzeria, which is opening a second location in New Center. And I talked to owner Dave Mancini. I first heard about their second location in August 2018. And he's hoping he's going to open maybe next month. So that's February 2021. So that's a long stretch. So even without a pandemic, there was delays in getting new places off the ground. And there's a whole new set of problems. But one good thing about opening now is you can take into account safety, staffing issues, laws, regulations, and kind of hit the ground running when you know what to expect.
Supino's was one of my favorite restaurants to eat at when I worked down in the Eastern Market area. Just about 20 seconds left here with you, Melody, before we let you go. The top three restaurants we need to try this year.
Oh, this year. Well, I'm hearing a lot about Baobab Fair and News Center. They're not open yet, but I'm hearing great things. They're going to be, like I said, partially a market, partially a juice bar, partially a cafe. I think that's going to be a really exciting new opening. I'm excited for the new Supinos to open. And let's see, off the top of my head, the Beer Exchange downtown, I think, is going to be interesting. It's a beer bar. They've also got a kind of arcade space, and the beer is priced kind of like in a stock market way, where if a beer is popular, the price is going to go up. And if people aren't drinking it, it's not being ordered, the price goes down. Something different, something cool that's coming in downtown Detroit, hopefully in the beginning of 2021.
Let's hope. Melody Baetens with us. She's the restaurant critic for the Detroit News. How can we follow you on Twitter?
At Melody Baetens.
Great. Thank you so much. We want to, we appreciate your time as well as your insight. Support your local restaurants because they need it now more so than ever to keep their doors open.